Hi, everybody. Welcome to another installment of Coffee, Tea, and Meat. Today, we're sitting here with Marla, our wonderful, amazing, fabulous, terrific crochet instructor. And I can actually vouch for that personally because me, who has said she could never, ever, ever learn to crochet, is learning. I'm learning. That's bad English.
I am learning.
You know, what can I say? I haven't had the coffee yet, guys. So we're going to spend a few minutes chatting with Marla and learning about her and our crochet. And I am wearing, if it lasts the whole interview, this is Forbidden Fibers is the yarn. And this is
Sprinkling
Shawl. And it was one of my favorite yarns. It's now called Mythic, and we will have it back in the store. And it has a little Stellina in it. I thought on this wonderful bright summer day, it'd be fun to pop a little color and see what's going on. So hi, Marla.
Hello, Stacy.
How you doing?
I'm doing swell.
Well, you are doing swell. How many crochet classes do we have now? Do you know?
I think 142.
It feels like
that.
It might be four.
We have Monday, Tuesday, and Thursday mornings, and then Thursday evenings as
and
well.
And September we're adding.
And then Wednesday night, Shay teaches, and in September, in the evening, Rebecca will start a class as well.
On Monday.
Andy told me to say that. I'm being prompted.
She's always here.
Where are the cue cards?
It's very helpful.
It really is.
That's great. All right, so I pretty much ask everybody the same four questions. I didn't bring any crochet with me because I wouldn't be able to ask questions in crochet because I'm still such a beginner. But if you are happy to continue, we'll talk about the project you're working on at some point. Feel free to just keep crocheting along.
I will do that.
But let's start with, how did you get into it? Did you learn at grandma's knee or?
Well, you know what? My grandmother actually did crochet, and she crocheted even when she was blind, because she had that the muscle memory. And so it was really interesting as a little girl. She did a lot of, was it tatting?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes.
And made some beautiful doilies, and my sisters, I think, have those.
We'll have to talk to them.
Of those, yeah. No.
If you're watching, girls, send one this way.
Yeah. But yeah, so I watched her, and then when I was a teenager, one of my mother's friends actually taught me to crochet. And I think we learned to knit in Girl Scouts a little bit. I think that was for a badge.
Yeah, so. I think I had that
yeah,
badge.
Yeah, I think so. But mostly crocheting, and it just, do you remember when I learned to crochet, it was all granny squares.
Yep.
And every granny square was trimmed in black or cream.
Yes.
And then they sewed them together to make all kinds of
interesting
clothing. Yeah, they, you know, blankets and vests and really boxy sweaters, but it was all, you know, it was all granny squares. And the other day I was looking on Etsy for vintage patterns, and they did have men's shorts. It's not a good look. I don't recommend anybody. I think they should be outlawed. But men's granny square shorts were in a vintage pattern. So we've come a long way.
Well, we certainly have come a long way. Look at this beautiful shawl, guys. Marla, you knit the sample for this for the shawl.
I did not knit it. I crocheted.
Oh my, you crocheted.
See, this is a problem.
It is. It's like my snowboarder daughter who gets upset when I say ski.
Not needles.
But yeah. Much more modern, really beautiful.
But those are granny clusters, believe it or not. And this would be a granny cluster as well, because they've kind of made a comeback.
Right.
But
everywhere you look in the stores and Target, everywhere you see crocheted items. Or I just saw a vest, but the sleeves were crocheted and the waist was crocheted.
Exactly. So. It's come back. And also, kids, teenagers, young men and women are wanting to crochet now. And so it's an interesting mix. And in my classes, when you think about it, I have 12-year-olds and I have 93-year-olds. And that multi-generational group, that's kind of fun and exciting.
That is exciting.
Yeah, yeah.
And we had the 8 to 12-year-olds at Kids Craft Club, yeah. and they were all learning how to crochet. So that was really fun.
Yeah.
Okay, so so you come by it honestly. You learned when you were young. And how did you end up at Craftworks?
Well.
Let's sit back and have that story.
It was a year ago, maybe a little over a year ago, and I've always shopped at Craftworks. And I was a customer for a really long time. And one of the newsletters said that you were looking for crochet instructors and to, you know, come on in and bring your work. And so I piled in my, the you know, crochet work that I had and came in and started teaching from there. I sat in on a few classes and the rest is history.
The rest is history.
Yeah.
So I always, this is a really hard question, but I always ask it. Do you have a favorite project, favorite stitch, a favorite, like what, a favorite thing to crochet?
My favorite thing is whatever I'm working on, always. When
that's
I
great.
Yeah, and if I don't like it, I usually ditch it. And that's what I tell people in my class as well. If you're not having fun with a project, are you having fun with your tote bag?
I am loving this little market bag.
Yeah. But didn't you have a couple that you didn't like?
Yeah, I did.
And you just said, I'm not doing
it. I'm not
it.
Doing
it. You didn't
it.
Like the yarn or you didn't like
right.
the bag. And so that's my best advice. You have to like what you're doing.
And you have to like the yarn. We tell the knitters, I always tell the customers, knitters or crocheters, that it's going to be in your hand. You know, knit with beautiful yarn
that's
that we
exactly
have
right.
and yarn colors that you like. We actually had a shop sample experience with yarn colors that we didn't like. Was that crochet or knit? Wait a minute. That may have been a knit sample. But we've had that.
Oh, no, we've had it with crochet
we
samples.
We have, yeah.
Summer sesame.
But
yes.
usually it's stuff that I've picked because I don't have
oh,
much
don't
of
ever.
No, I don't. I always go safe. And so I guess another, the,
this one?
Yeah, it's the Kuma, or Kuma. Crow Kuma cow. And this was Emma.
This is Emma.
And it was.
Oh, and this has
mohair. Yeah, and I'd never worked with mohair before. I don't know who put this together. This was a kit that I got during COVID. Not that I had COVID, but during COVID.
During shutdown and such.
And I saw the kit. I think it was online. And the colors, I would never have picked these colors, but it's a really pretty, it's a really pretty scarf.
Put it on.
It's a little warm.
It's a little warm.
It's a little warm.
It's a little warm.
But yeah.
But the colors
but
are
the
great.
The colors are really
yeah.
pretty. So.
And actually, you brought it in and let us show it as a sample, and we sold out of the kits. So it's really nice to be able to see. I think a lot of people do think. I think even new crocheters always think, oh, it's only granny squares. But you certainly have shown us. With your samples
yeah,
and what we do. As a
be.
Matter of fact, you're working on,
this is
the
called,
linen?
This is a linen stitch. This is called the Specklework cowl. And it could be made, this I'm using minis, Emma's minis. You could use scrap yarn. It's just done in the round. And
it's a lot of stitches.
It doesn't take long though. It really doesn't. It doesn't take that long. So I think it's really pretty.
I think it's beautiful.
Yeah, so.
All right, the other question I always ask, and I usually just say, give us a mistake story, but I think for a lot of new crocheters, experienced crocheters, knitters, quilters, potters, anybody, I think that, what do you do with your mistakes? What we all have stories about them, and they all teach us something, so I always think it's fun to hear.
What do I do with mistakes? Sometimes I just keep going. Sometimes I can live with mistakes. Now, this is interesting. I have the Monday morning gal who made the beautiful sweater. We realized after she started working on the body that she was doing it wrong, but it was beautiful. I said, do you like it? And she said she did. So she finished the sweater.
It's a design choice.
It was a design choice. And actually I tried making the same sweater with the same pattern, and I liked her mistake sweater better, so I would change that pattern. So, and most of my mistakes come on easy patterns because I don't concentrate. Something that's hard or more complicated, I'll sit and, you know, I won't have the TV on.
Right.
I'll just work on it. But I get overconfident sometimes and then realize that I've got a big mess. So
sometimes I guess you have to take them out, and sometimes the design choice to leave them is perfectly
that
fine.
That is exactly right. That's exactly right. But everybody makes mistakes, and sometimes the best way to learn is to just keep going. When people are practicing, you know, when they're first starting a project, they just need to keep going with it, even if there are mistakes in it, just to kind of get into the groove of crochet.
I agree. I happen to agree. And I'm going to ask this question, and usually people look at me and go, what are you asking me? But that's okay. What do you wish you knew when you started as a teacher, when you started as a crocheter, now that you've been crocheting for a long time? What would you tell someone either who's new? I mean, you told me a lot of really good things. I really was very helpful. But what advice would you give someone who is looking at these tools, is looking at beautiful yarn, and
maybe just try new things? I always played it safe. You know, if I found a pattern I'd like, I would do 100 projects in that pattern because I knew that I could do it. But it's okay to try new things and make mistakes and, you know, just give it a go.
Just jump in if you don't have a clue what you're doing and make a market bag.
This is interesting too, because older adults, more seasoned adults, like to use patterns and they like to play it safe. Now you take my kids that I'm teaching in class, and the teenagers and the young adults, you teach them stitches. They don't necessarily want patterns. They're taking off and making these great creative choices, and that's fun to watch. And that's something, I guess that's what I'd like to do that too. I'd like to be able to just say, well, I don't need a pattern. I can just crochet away.
Right. And
kind of a freestyle.
Yeah, and something sort of like a crazy quilt or something. And something will come of what you've made.
Yeah, because I'll say to them, you know, let me teach you how to read a pattern. And, you know, no thanks.
That's like teaching them to read music.
But they're learning a different way. You think about how we learned. We just had a pattern. We didn't have YouTube. We didn't have videos, and so they're learning in a completely different way, which is kind of exciting. And the fact that crochet has become a thing for young people, that's exciting. Take that, netters. Excuse me. Maybe take that out. I'm sorry.
There might be a showdown in the shop, guys. Maybe we
show
should
show me your young people. I'm teasing because I like to knit as well. But crocheting has kind of taken over my time since I started teaching classes.
Well, you have done beautiful work, and you continue to do beautiful work. And Marla is certainly, when we do kits now, we always have a knit kit and a crochet kit, because we have Marla to help me figure out how to do that, because, quite frankly, I'm just at the very beginning of my crocheting world here. But I thank you so much. We are so lucky to have you.
Well, I'm lucky to be here. I love Craftworks.
Oh, yeah.
And I love the time that I spend here. So it's just been a gift.
It is a gift to us as well, and a gift to all of you. Do me a favor. Get online. Subscribe to our YouTube channel. Check us out on the websites. There are spaces in some of the classes, and we're adding that Monday evening class. And keep your eye out for special projects. Crochet is up and coming. As always, guys, happy crocheting.
Ooh, good job.